special about today? It's Sunday. Sundays are always special. People came with pies. The paper came with pie sheets. Okay. Does anybody know there's two things that are special about today? Candles are always there. This is the Episcopal Church. We do candles. How about All Saints Day? What does All Saints Day mean? It's a day when we commemorate saints. Who are saints? Okay. Well, people who have that big Saint Paul, all these people that show up in the Bible and later on that really did pretty awesome stuff for God, right? Well, sometimes we forget that we also are called to be saints. And being a saint has certain responsibilities and it has certain privileges. We get adopted in baptism as saints, as children of God. If you're a child of God, you're automatically a saint. But we like to reserve this day, All Saints Day, for all those people who maybe the church forgot to commemorate, who've already died, and yet have that big capital S saint that means that they're already in God's presence in heaven. What we call the church expectant. Well, there's a second thing that we're commemorating today. Well, it's more of a thing that we do every year for the church. Anybody know what that is? We made an announcement. There's a brunch, and what's the brunch celebrating? Well, it happens to fall on All Saints Day, but there's something else. No, not quite. We're not quite there. We're definitely not there. We call it Spiritual Giving Sunday this year. In years past, we used to call it Consecration Sunday. What happens on that day? That's All Saints Day. Yeah. What about Spiritual Giving Sunday? Why do we get together and have a catered brunch and come together and celebrate and we bring something in, or we mail something in that's really important so the church can keep going?
Money.
What about money? We say what we're going to give for the next year, right? And so people fill out, let's not do that, Dan, please. So we fill out these cards, and then that tells the church how much it is that we're going to give so that the church can have a future. Now, how do you suppose people figure out how much they ought to give?
Okay.
By how much they don't want. Now, that would be a really bad way of thinking because everybody wants all their money. But you bring up a very important point. And that is that money is important, isn't it? That's awesome theology there. God owns everything. So everything we offer to God comes out of what he's already given us, right? We even say sometimes when there's no music in church and the offering is brought forth, we say, all things come of you, O Lord, and your own have we given. That's pretty awesome. Well, I'd like to have three volunteers. Okay. Leo had her hand up first. I'm going to pick Aaron. Okay. You're going to have to defer to you here. You two pick out one of their three things in my magic box for today. What's that? And you, yes. Okay, come on, sit down. Okay, so let's start with Aaron. Aaron, what do you have? It is giant in comparison with you, isn't it? Yes, but it's a bank where a child would place the money that they're trying to save, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Now, Bennett, what do you have in your bag?
Dimes.
How many of them specifically? $10 in there.
You guessed it right.
Okay. And let me know what you have.
10 cents.
$1. Is there any difference between what's in here and what's in here?
No. Yeah, they're both equal $1.
They both equal $1.
Yes.
Okay.
They're both different things. Let's see.
Right. But they're worth the same amount, right? Okay. Let's take out those dimes. Because if you go to a bank and you break a big bill, you say you want change, they can give you the right amount of change that equals what your bill means. So this $1 is equal to $10. Now, if I were trying to determine what it is, that God was trying to make me recognize how I should give to my church, how do you think you would figure that out? I think the amount that you give is between you and God, but it's important that we give it unbegrudgingly and that we give it with purpose, give regularly, because the church needs that in order to continue. But there's an Old Testament way of figuring it out. Back in the days when everybody was a farmer, well, pretty much everybody, they would gather up their crops every year and they would reserve 1/10 of those crops for the people who were called the Levites. They were the priests of the day. So it was like, where's the piggy bank? It's like saying, okay, here is the temple treasury. I'm going to give that to God in thankfulness for my harvest, 1/10 of everything. Now, there's an important principle, though, behind that 1/10. And it reminds us of a story that goes way back in the beginning of the Bible to Genesis. Anybody remember the story about Cain and Abel? Ryan does, kind of. Okay, what can you tell me about Cain and Abel? Okay. Adam and Eve's children, what happens to them? Turn what? He turned evil. One of them, what did you say? One of them was evil from the other. And here's what. You see, both Abel and Cain gave offerings to God. Now, Abel was a shepherd, so Abel gave a lamb, the best lamb he had, one that didn't have any blemishes, and it was the first lamb he had, so it was the first and the best. Now, in contrast, Cain, who was a farmer, gave vegetables, but he gave what was left over instead of what was first and what was best. And in those days, the way that you understood whether a sacrifice was accepted by God or not was whether or not it burned. Well, Abel's sacrifice burned, Cain's sacrifice didn't. And Cain was pretty upset. So Cain said, you know, what gives here? I gave 1/10, but he didn't give graciously. He didn't give love in his heart. He gave the leftovers. So part of the way that we understand now today about how it is we give to our church family is we give lovingly the first and the best, not what's left over. And then there's another biblical promise we read in the book of the prophet Malachi. And Malachi says that whatever we give to God, those tithes, that 10% that we give to God, God multiplies in a way that we can't even contain the blessing that's given in response to it. So that means we cannot, in any way, shape, or form, ever outgive God. Whatever God gives us, he's going to give it back and more. That's a promise. That's a promise for every little thing that we drop in the church's piggy bank. And so I'm going to start something a little bit different here. And that is that I am going to encourage you to start a pattern of spiritual giving at this point in your life. So when you receive some sort of money, I want you to think about what is it that God is wanting me to give back that is the first and the best. And remember that God can never outgive God. God will always outgive you. Can I have a piggyback? Piggyback? So I'm going to be leaving this in the back of the church each Sunday. So we're going to then have it available so that when you get something that is your best and your first, and you'd like to give that to God, knowing that you can't outgive him and he's always going to be able to give you far more than you could ever give him. And then we'll ask the ushers to bring it up on you Sunday each month so that that way your offering can be included in what it is that God receives during God's tour. So what have we learned? Number one, we give God what is first and best. And can we outgive God?
No.
God always gives more.